Bueno, buenas tardes a todos otra vez. Como anunciamos o comentamos en la convención pasada hace un año, tuvimos el honor de ser invitados por la compañía RNS, Risk Management Solutions, una compañía muy importante de modelación de riesgos catastróficos. Pues ellos tuvieron la amabilidad de invitarnos hace un año más o menos a ser parte de una iniciativa que se llama, una nueva plataforma que se llama RMS One, la cual, pues como una innovación en esta industria, es una plataforma de cómputo que es capaz de correr en ella tanto los modelos de RMS como modelos de otros proveedores, por ejemplo nosotros. Entonces, empezamos a trabajar hace un año aproximadamente, o sea, un poco más, en la implementación de nuestros modelos de riesgo catastrófico a la plataforma de RMS. Y esta es una tarea que ha sido muy interesante, muy, muy buena para nosotros, y que hemos ido, en la que hemos ido avanzando bastante rápido. Actualmente, como se anunció en la convención de RMS en abril pasado, tenemos ya operando en la plataforma de RMS One nuestros modelos de terremoto de México y de Perú. Entonces, pues nosotros hemos considerado una distinción, una diferencia, haber sido una de las primeras compañías que fuimos invitados por RMS a esta actividad, y de hecho nuestro modelo de México fue el primero o el segundo quizá de modelos de terceros partidos, de terceras personas que empezaron a correr ya en la plataforma de RMS. Esto es algo que pues ya iremos platicando con más detalle con nuestros clientes. Digamos, en pocas palabras, lo que va a ocurrir es que en el futuro nuestros modelos van a poder ser operados desde nuestra interfaz, como ahora, pero también van a poder ser operados desde la interfaz de RMS, desde la plataforma RMS One, y pues para nuestros clientes será optativo utilizar nuestra propia plataforma o utilizar la plataforma de RMS para esto. Es algo que iremos viendo más adelante. Entonces, pues para platicar en esta convención con más detalle sobre esta iniciativa de RMS, cómo va a funcionar, cuáles son las ideas que motivaron su creación, hemos invitado y le agradecemos mucho la deferencia de venir a nuestra convención al señor Matt Reed de RMS, Risk Management Solutions. El señor Reed es vicepresidente de desarrollo de socios de negocios en RMS, en sus oficinas de California. Su trabajo en RMS es justamente llevar a la plataforma de RMS One modelos de proveedores externos a RMS, y hacerlos parte de lo que él nos va a platicar, que es el ecosistema de RMS. Antes de tener estas funciones de digamos, llevar modelos de terceros a RMS, él se concentraba en asuntos relacionados con computación de alto desempeño y con computación en la nube. Así que pueden estar tranquilos, él es un ingeniero, así como nosotros. De hecho, es ingeniero eléctrico, ingeniero electrónico de la Universidad de Portsmouth. El señor Reed tiene más de 20 años de experiencia en empresas de tecnología, en actividades muy variadas que van desde el desarrollo de software hasta actividades de comunicación y mercadotecnia. Y pues antes de trabajar en RMS, donde tiene mucho tiempo, él trabajó 14 años en una gran empresa que seguramente muchos recuerdan, que es Sun Microsystems. Entonces él trabajó. Le platicaba yo a Matt hoy en el desayuno que hubo una época en que yo me imaginaba el paraíso como un lugar en que todo el mundo tenía una Sun, ¿no? una Sun Workstation, era una compañía fabulosa. Bueno, entonces Matt trabajó en esa compañía durante muchos años antes de trabajar en RMS. Entonces yo le quiero dar gracias por haber venido y pues the floor is yours.
Buenas tardes.
Bueno, damos un aplauso de bienvenida.
Muchas gracias, Mario, por la introducción y la invitación a la Ciudad de México. Es una gran oportunidad para hablar con los clientes de AI. Perdóname, pero no tengo más habilidad de hablar en español, así que voy a hablar en inglés. Gracias a todos ustedes por su permiso. I won't torture you anymore with my Spanish. So the first question we should probably ask ourselves is, how does an Englishman living in California, working for risk management solutions, find himself in Mexico City at an ERM conference? And this is a story that goes back close to 10 years. And about 10 years ago, RMS and ERM got together and thought about how could we distribute ERM models through RiskLink, our current modeling software. We thought it would be a very interesting thing to do. We thought a lot of clients would appreciate it. But guess what? It couldn't be done. The way we had built RiskLink and the way nearly all existing modeling environments are built, the computational engines and the financial engines are so closely tied with the modeling logic that you can't tease those things apart and bring in a model from a third party. Well, fast forward a few years. And things have changed. Here's Mario on stage at the RMS client conference in Washington, D.C. about 8 weeks ago. And Mario was with us in Washington, D.C. because we are indeed now able to have ERM's models running in the new version of our modeling environment, which is what we call RMS1. And before I go further, I would like to take this opportunity to thank Mario and Eduardo and the rest of the team at ERM for being really good partners to work with. You will know them as their clients. We now know them as partners and as an organization to work with and to work through issues with. They have been exemplary. And so, gentlemen, thank you. So let me now move on and talk a little bit about RMS1. Oops. What is RMS1? RMS1 is a real-time exposure and risk management system. It is an entirely new software environment which we have built from the ground up to be delivered entirely as software as a service in the cloud and to accommodate the needs of our modeling organization who want to build their next generation of models. At the same time, we identified a gap in our clients' systems. And that gap was there's no system of record in most of our clients' organizations for exposure and risk data. They have systems of record for claims, they have systems of record for policy administration. But where's the system of record for exposure data? It's very often a SQL database here, a SQL database there. And if you go in and try and audit that as a system of record, it's a pretty tough job. We also wanted to deliver a richer set of analytics that sit either side of the modeling our function itself. So very often, you can gain a lot of insight, as you all know, by looking at your exposures, looking for accumulations, for instance, before you even get to the process of modeling. So why not build that all into one environment? As you look downstream of modeling, the process of rolling up results so you can get a single consistent view of your business, if you're using models from RMS for one geography, you're using models from ERN for another geography, heaven forbid you're using models from AIR for something else, you still want to be able to roll all of those results up to get your singular view of your entire book of business. So we're building a roll-up function as well that can roll up all results that reside in RMS1. So as we thought about building this platform, we noticed a few things that were going on. One is, if you go to a lot of the reinsurers, the big reinsurers, particularly in Bermuda, a lot of them have built something like this, actually. But they hate it. And they hate it because when they first built it, it gave them a competitive advantage. But over time, as their competitors built the same system, it was no longer a competitive advantage. It simply became a maintenance headache. This was now a software system that was critical to their business that they had to maintain. So we went to a bunch of those clients and said, look, if we offered you a build versus buy option, would you be interested? And the vast majority said, that makes so much sense to me now that I would love that. So that's what we're building with RMS1. And I'll dive a little bit later into the fact that I've identified client models and third-party models in this diagram. So we'll come back to this. But there's another trend that's really important to understand. And that is if you go back 10, 15 years, when modeling was really coming up in the industry, a lot of the time a client would say, I've got my model output from my model, good enough for me, that's my number, right? I now understand my risk. Well, as we all know, that's really not the right way to view your own risk. We were handily reminded in the panel that models are simply tools, and we would acknowledge that. And that often, clients want to use one or more models for the same risk. And that's the reality of the world that we live in. So that's one trend, and that's what this sort of no lifeguard on duty, swim at your own risk refers to. It's about, you know, you need to own your risk. You can't cede the ownership of the understanding of your risk to RMS, to ERN, or any other modeling company. It's your risk, you carry it, you own it. At the same time, though, the infrastructure overheads for running models have been going up and up and up. And there's a trend, or at least a desire in the industry to consolidate modeling platforms, simply because the overhead is so great when you run models from three or four different vendors. So that's the first trend that we saw. And the second is one, actually, which is very dear to my heart. And this brings us back to Sun Microsystems. This is Bill Joy, he's one of the founders of Sun Microsystems. I was lucky enough to work with him for a number of years. And Bill was famous for making this statement that no matter who you are, most of the smart people work for someone else. Right? And that's simply scale, right? We like to think there are a lot of smart people that work at RMS. You know, Mario and Eduardo have a lot of smart people working at ERN, but the truth of the matter is, lots of smart people work for somebody else. And if you can find a way to get those smart people to come together, to aggregate all of those smarts and deliver value together to one client set, you can do something really special. And so we were looking for a way that we could leverage, along with our own modeling capabilities, those of all of our existing competitors to add value to the experience that our clients have. And so that's what drove us. Maybe I'm holding this upside down. No, I got it now. It's like, all right. See, smart people. but look, this is, I mean, this may sound a little bit theoretical in this notion of building platforms and having others come build on your platform. There are lots of examples of this. Probably the one that I used to use all the time were our friends at Apple. We built an iPhone and launched it with, I know what, 10 apps on it. And then 6 months later, started a developer program. And now, and there've been billions, right? 5 billion about 18 months ago, download of apps onto this thing. I'm so pleased that ERN are embracing the mobile world. Tonight, I'm going to go, before I step foot back in my hotel, I'm going to download the app and check out the place that Mario recommended to me. But look, here's another really interesting example. Somebody who does this and for whom it makes sense. John Deere, makers of large agricultural equipment. This is a cotton picker. It weighs nearly 70,000 tons, and its job is to pick cotton as fast as it can. But it's not just a cotton picker. It's got highly sensitive GPS equipment built into it. It measures the exact yield it gets as it picks cotton. It measures the water content of the cotton that it picks. And it stores all of that data inside of the machine. And that's all really useful data that growers can use, particularly if they can marry that data, the yield data, with the data they get off the machine that planted the seeds. And the GPS systems on these machines are good enough that they can correlate exactly where I put the seed, right, and how much yield I got, and how much fertilizer I put down on that seed as it grew. So what does John Deere do? They have a developer program. They publish a programming interface to all of these data sets, and they have a developer program. And third parties that have better ideas than John Deere have for how you can bring that data together and add value to the operator of this machinery are welcome to join their developer program, develop applications, and distribute them to John Deere's clients. So it's not just the software industry, it's an idea that really makes sense. So what about RMS? Let's come back to RMS-1, and let's talk about RMS-1 as a platform for innovation, the same way you might think of the cotton picker as a platform for innovation. So we have architected RS1, as I said, to be a system of record for client data, specifically for exposure and results data, exposure and risk data. When we have that data residing in RMS1, you can draw the analogy out from the John Deere cotton picker. If we publish programming interfaces to this platform, then others can build applications that can dig into that data and run analytics on it in ways that we may not have thought of. Or they may build some analytics to do things that we have thought of. And they may do them better than we did. And that's fine. That's part of what you unlock when you pursue a strategy like this. It's about offering choice to the user of your platform. And choice is a good thing, right? I presume it is. I think it is. But we've done something else outside of the programming interface. We decided that we should open up this platform to other providers of catastrophe models. And you can see lurking inside of the box, which is labeled the RMS1 platform, you can see client models and you can see third-party models. And this is exactly where our collaboration with ERN fits. ERN have been working to deploy their models natively on RMS1. As part of the environment you all as clients could access. If you choose to do that, you would access an ERN model through exactly the same user interface, using exactly the same underlying data store, using exactly the same analytics, using exactly the same financial engine as you would if you accessed an RMS1, an RMS model, or a model from any of our other partners. So there are some nice unifying themes that we can see here. Just one example, if you want to understand the difference between two models. Typically what you have to do today is run those two models and dig into ground up losses to understand where the differences in the two models really reside, right? Because if you let them run the financial engine, you know that every financial engine is a little bit different and it will treat certain contract structures slightly differently. In this model, you wouldn't have to do that because you would flow your ground-up losses through exactly the same financial engine. So you could compare model results at the real point where it counts, right? Which is net of all the contract terms, how do the models compare? I'd also point out that one significant advantage we believe this brings is in terms of the ability and the speed with which, as a client, you can deploy models. RMS1 will be software as a service, so the process of deploying a new model into that environment is as simple as speaking to the provider of that model, signing a license, and then RMS, once we're notified you're entitled to that license, will turn it on. And then it just appears in RMS1. So we do think of RMS1 really as a platform for building innovation and bringing choice in terms of modeling capabilities, in terms of application capabilities, and in terms of data sets and hazard layers and hazard footprints. We will also be able to bring in third-party data layers when we get to that point. Now, I mentioned with John Deere that they have a developer network, and we have one as well. And this is a critical part of this strategy to build an ecosystem of providers. But it's not enough just to build a technology platform and say, here it is, if you want to build, put something on here, have at it. It doesn't work that way. So ERN are de facto founding members of the RMS1 developer network. And this is the mechanism that we use to support all of our partners or our clients who want to build their own applications or their own models and deploy them on RMS1. And it's a pretty comprehensive program. It's staffed by a team that mirrors my team in business development that we call developer relations. And we have experts in modeling, we have experts in programming. And their remit is to build all of these things that you see here, which help partners build and deploy capabilities on our. And it's probably just worth calling out at this stage something up there called the RMS1 MDK. That is the Model Development Kit. And what the Model Development Kit is essentially a standalone set of interfaces to RMS1 that a model developer can take, deploy on their own internal machines, and use to develop their model, factor their model so that it will interface with RMS1. So a large amount of the work required to get a model ready to run on RMS-1 can be done entirely independent of us. And I think, I hope at least, that Mario and his team would concur that this is a very powerful tool that speeds up development. And then we back it up, of course, with developer support. Right? So we have folks at RMS whose sole job is to support partners like ERN and their development teams. So this is, this is a very significant undertaking on our part. And if you think back to where we started, we went down this road because we want to deliver choice to our clients. We know they want choice. We know you want to run models for more than one vendor. And so that's what we need to deliver. So the first vendor that is absolutely committed to delivering models on RMS-1 is RMS. And this is our modeling suite. The shaded areas show the territories that, for which we have models. Right? And if you sort of add up the peril country pairs, we have probabilistic, we have 180 probabilistic models in our catalog. Through the work that we've been doing over the past year or so, you've got to a point where we have a pipeline of over 280 models now in that catalog. And the impact of that, as hopefully you can see, is that the breadth of coverage that will be available on RMS-1 is greatly increased. So there are now geographies and perils which we have not modeled, and we may not have any intention of modeling, for which you can get a view of risk on RMS-1. But at least as importantly, there is now depth of coverage. So if you don't like RMS's view of, let's pick one that's far away from here, of Australia bushfire, no, Australia hail, right? Then you can go to one of our partners who also has a model for that peril. You could go to Risk Frontiers, or you could go to Congress and say, I would like your model rather than RMS's model, or your models in addition to RMS's model, so you can build an ensemble view of that risk and understand the spread of how the models characterize the risk and make more informed decisions. I need to show you this. It's kind of hard to read, but this is ERN's Mexico quake model running in beta release of RMS-1. So it's real, it's live, it generates losses, along with a number of other third-party models that we're running today. And we'll continue to build out that catalog as we release RMS-1 and deploy future versions. So this really is the net of this story in terms of modeling. Where we've gotten to is we have 10 committed modeling vendors to this platform, including RMS. We have about 100 partner models in that pipeline, and they break down about 50% incremental or new views of existing coverages and 50% entirely new risks that we haven't modeled. Just a couple of other comments about a couple of application vendors that you might be interested in hearing about. First is a company called Analyze Re. Anybody heard of Analyze Re? Mm-hmm. Mario. So Analyze Re are a startup based out of Canada, and they actually were a large part of the software engineering and analytical team at Flagstone. And then Validus acquired Flagstone. And I'm not sure exactly the sequence of events here, but I think the team that is now Analyze Re saw the writing on the wall and decided to branch out on their own and build a reinsurance pricing application and a portfolio optimization tool. And they came to our client conference just over a year ago and heard us talking about this idea we had around an ecosystem, and immediately realized that this was an opportunity for them to get product into market faster by not having to build a lot of software that wasn't their value add. Right, so Analyzery now have built their application. It uses RMS-1 as a system of record for the results data. It uses RMS-1's financial engine to generate some of the iterations on loss calculations and portfolio level outputs that they need to do their optimization. And they've simply been able to build an application faster and bring it to market in a time that otherwise they wouldn't be able to do. And another startup, albeit a more mature startup that some of you may be aware of, is a company called Spatial Key. Spatial Key are really experts. They started out as experts in geospatial visualization and analytics. So bringing the ability to slice and dice data sets in many different ways and visualize them very effectively is really their specialty. And they now focus on the insurance and the reinsurance space. And we are working with Spatial Key to provide a smooth integration between data which is stored in RMS-1 as the system of record to their analytical front end. And so they have exposure, analytical capabilities, they run accumulations, they do some exposure assessment at the point of underwriting. And we're working with Spatial Key to find ways where we can tightly integrate the two systems, such that the client doesn't have to worry about exporting data from one system and importing it into another. Right? They can just say, oh, look at these exposures. And they happen to reside in RMS-1, and they get pulled over automatically into Spatial Key. So just two examples of interesting applications that add to the value that can be extracted, frankly, from RMS-1 when we open up our interfaces to third parties. And make no mistake, in some cases, competitors. We build our own exposure analytical tools. So now a client will have a choice. They can use ours, or they can choose to use Spatial Keys. That's the nature of the direction we move in. So that's what the RS1 ecosystem is all about. I hope that's given you some insight, not just into what we are doing, but why we are doing it. So I think it's really important to understand why. You know, why are we choosing to work with modeling companies who traditionally we would have seen as our competitors? What is the motivation behind that? Hopefully now you understand that. And we are at a point where we have this rich and growing portfolio of models and a growing suite of application, and it's really all enabled by this robust API and integration tools and developer support. And just to close, and reiterate, I'm really excited by the work we're doing with ERN. ERN were actually the second company that we called, in fact, simply because our first contact at ERN is no longer at ERN. So it took us a little bit of time to find them, but we're really excited to be working with ERN. We think having their models on RMS-1 will be of real value to our mutual clients. And with that, I'll close and take questions if we've got a few minutes. Which is Crescens.
Bien, tenemos tiempo para algunas preguntas. Va a ser importante que la hagan en el micrófono para que tengamos la traducción. Walter.
When will this be ready, operational?
So the question was,
When will this be operational?
The answer is there will be a pre-production release likely sometime later this year, and then we expect production release of our first clients early in 2015. And as soon as that happens, as soon as we get to that point, in fact, even in the pre-production release, the models from ERN and some of our other partners that are already ported, if you will, to RMS-1 will also be available.
¿Tiene alguna otra pregunta? Mario says that he has a difficult one.
So it would sound strange to build a system that will bring your competitors' products to your own clients. So maybe that's the sign of these times. But could you give us some explanation of this apparent anomaly?
Sure. Yeah. Hey Mario, it's all driven by what our clients need. If we want to deliver a really valuable system to them, it has to have the capabilities they want, and clients for years have been crying out for a multi-model environment. That's one answer. Another answer that I didn't feel I had time to get into in the presentation though is, you could go further than your question, and you could say, RMS has built a very strong business over the course of the past 25 years in an industry where the barrier to entry is very, very high. And why would you do something like this, which is effectively lowering that barrier to entry? Right, and what that really comes down to is that ultimately, part of the mission that really all of us have in the modeling space is about making the world a more resilient place. And the more views of risk that we can bring to bear on that process, the better. So we do have a belief that there are viable organizations out there today with the right level of scientific and engineering expertise to build useful models, but without the software engineering capabilities, without the ability to build a financial engine that could be useful, sometimes without even an understanding of how to get into the market. So that's the other angle, right? It's ultimately, if you think that part of what we need to do is make this world a more resilient place for all of us, you want to bring as many views of risk to bear on that problem as you can. So is that a good answer? All right.
Muy bien, ¿alguna otra pregunta? Bien, si no hay ninguna otra, entonces agradecemos a Matt su presentación. Y para cerrar con esta convención anual, le dejo la palabra a nuestro presidente Mario Ordaz.
Bueno, gracias, Laura.
Esta vez sí me tocó hablar mucho. Bueno, pues simplemente yo quisiera dar las gracias a todos ustedes por venir. Cada una de estas conferencias o convenciones, ya vamos en la número 12, creo que cada una ha sido diferente. Hemos ido cambiando un poco. En esta ocasión hubo quizá menos presentaciones técnicas, pero hubo otras un poco más filosóficas y sobre otros temas pues de interés, como los que se trataron aquí en el panel, ¿no? Pues quiero agradecerle también a todas las personas que hablaron, que me hicieron favor de hablar, algunos ya ya se fueron, Carlos Valdés creo que ya se fue, todos nuestros conferencistas, muchas gracias. Ya les iremos contando sobre cómo vamos avanzando en esta transición, posible transición entre nuestra plataforma y la plataforma de RMS One, que como hemos dicho pues será optativa para nuestros clientes, pero posiblemente sea útil y conveniente para algunos de ellos, especialmente creo para nuestros clientes globales va a ser una buena alternativa la de utilizar nuestros modelos desde la plataforma de RMS, pero pues ya iremos platicando con tiempo sobre este asunto. Pues nada más, muchas gracias a todos por su participación y nos vemos el año que viene. Muchas gracias. Hoy en el desayuno que hubo una época en que yo me imaginaba el paraíso como un lugar en que todo el mundo tenía una Sun, ¿no? una Sun Workstation, ¿no? Era una compañía fabulosa. Bueno, entonces Matt trabajó en esa compañía durante muchos años antes de trabajar en RMS, entonces yo le quiero dar gracias por haber venido y pues the floor is yours.
Buenas tardes.
Vale, damos un aplauso de bienvenida.
Muchas gracias, Mario, por la introducción y la invitación a la Ciudad de México. Es una gran oportunidad para hablar con los clientes de AI. Perdóname, pero no tengo más habilidad de hablar en español, así que voy a hablar en inglés. Gracias a todos ustedes por su permiso. I won't talk to you anymore.
Iremos platicando con más detalle con nuestros clientes. Digamos, en pocas palabras, lo que va a ocurrir es que en el futuro nuestros modelos van a poder ser operados desde nuestra interfaz, como ahora, pero también van a poder ser operados desde la interfaz de RMS, desde la plataforma RMS One, y pues para nuestros clientes será optativo utilizar nuestra propia plataforma o utilizar la plataforma de RMS para esto. Es algo que iremos viendo más adelante. Entonces, pues para platicar en esta convención con más detalle sobre esta iniciativa de RMS, cómo va a funcionar, cuáles son las ideas que motivaron su creación, hemos invitado y le agradecemos mucho la deferencia de venir a nuestra convención al señor Matt Reed de RMS, de Risk Management Solutions. El señor Reed es vicepresidente de desarrollo de socios de negocios en RMS, en sus oficinas de California. Bueno, buenas tardes a todos otra vez. Anunciamos o comentamos en la convención pasada hace un año, tuvimos el honor de ser invitados por la compañía RMS, Risk Management Solutions, una compañía muy importante de modelación de riesgos catastróficos, Pues ellos tuvieron la amabilidad de invitarnos hace un año más o menos a ser parte de una iniciativa que se llama, una nueva plataforma que se llama RMS One, la cual, pues como una innovación en esta industria, es una plataforma de cómputo que es capaz de correr en ella tanto los modelos de RMS como modelos de otros proveedores, por ejemplo nosotros. Entonces, empezamos a trabajar hace un año aproximadamente, o sea, un poco más, en la implementación de nuestros modelos de riesgo catastrófico a la plataforma de RMS. Y esta es una tarea que ha sido muy interesante, muy, muy buena para nosotros, y que hemos ido, en la que hemos ido avanzando bastante rápido. Actualmente, como se anunció en la convención de RMS en abril, en abril pasado, tenemos ya operando en la plataforma de RMS One nuestros modelos de terremoto de México y de Perú. Entonces, pues nosotros hemos considerado una distinción, una diferencia, haber sido una de las primeras compañías que fuimos invitados por RMS a esta actividad, y de hecho nuestro modelo de México fue el primero o el segundo quizá de modelos de terceros partidos, de terceras personas que empezaron a correr ya en la plataforma de RMS. Esto es algo que pues ya iremos, su trabajo en, la, en RMS es justamente llevar a la plataforma de RMS One modelos de proveedores externos a RMS, y hacerlos parte de lo que él nos va a, de lo que él nos va a platicar, que es el ecosistema de RMS. Antes de tener estas funciones de digamos, llevar modelos de terceros a RMS, él se concentraba en asuntos relacionados con computación de alto desempeño y con computación en la nube. Así que pueden estar tranquilos, él es un ingeniero, así como nosotros. De hecho, es ingeniero eléctrico, ingeniero electrónico de la Universidad de Portsmouth. El señor Reed tiene más de 20 años de experiencia en empresas de tecnología, en actividades muy variadas que van desde el desarrollo de software hasta actividades de comunicación y mercadotecnia. Y pues antes de trabajar en RMS, en RMS, donde tiene mucho tiempo, él trabajó 14 años en una gran empresa que seguramente muchos recuerdan, que es Sun Microsystems. Entonces él trabajó, le platicaba yo a